Here we are again, Harald Haarmann
and LaBGC.
Two hearts beating for a peaceful future in Europe and the world.
For our children, our grandchildren, and the generations to come.
In our recent video, we reflected on readiness to trust as the basis for dialogues. We also spoke about the right of self-determination and the advantage for communities. We spoke about communities in regions and about a Europe of regions. You, Harald, gave a survey of 3,000 peaceful and prosperous years of societies interacting and cooperating in the wider range of Southeastern Europe. 3,000 years without wars.
That's absolutely unique. That's exceptional in human evolution.
See, absolutely. Today, let's focus on the spirit of that period. What comes to mind immediately is the sense of solidarity among individuals and groups in societies. And isn't this the essence of democracy?
This is true indeed. The history of democracy is much older than what we are aware of. Everybody knows something about the history or the function of democracy simply because we live in a world with democratic institutions. The information we get from history lessons are common knowledge. And like many elements of common knowledge from our school education, that common knowledge is a cliché, is a stereotype, and you can call it a myth. But I don't like to live with clichés or stereotypes, and I think that goes for you too.
That's true.
I think we both are interested in the real thing. And recent scientific investigations and studies of cultural history have produced insights that show that there is another part in the history of democracy. The common knowledge is what is the told history, but there is another part, and that is the untold history. And it is only when we connect the told history with the untold, newly discovered untold history, can we make sense of many things in our history, in our view on the history of democracy that otherwise remain mysterious or cannot be explained. But let's first have a look at the told story of democracy. At school, we are taught Greece is the cradle of democracy, and the Greeks are very proud that their country was the first where this form of governance was introduced for state organization. In the 19th century, the representatives of the movement of German Romanticism even stressed it with enthusiasm and said, democracy is an expression of Greek ingenuity. And democracy, without doubt, is one of the great achievements of antiquity. And it deserves the label great because it has become one of the cornerstones of our Western civilization. And some say the introduction of democracy in antiquity was a breakthrough in political history. Our history books, we read that the founder of democracy was Cleisthenes, who in the year 507 BC introduced this model for state organization. And he promoted three basic principles or qualities. One was isegoria, which means the right to speak freely, the right of free speech. And that referred especially to the National Assembly, where elected members were supposed to speak freely, without restrictions. The other thing is isopolitea. And isopolitea means one individual has one vote. But as we well know, in Greek society, it was only the men who had the right to vote, not the women. And the third principle is isonomia. And that means equal status before the law. And also in this respect, we can see a difference. Women had Greek citizenship. So Athenian women were Athenian citizens. But when it came to the equality before the law, well, there were differences. For instance, women could inherit like men. But once they had their inheritance, they were obliged to choose a guardian for them. They could not make use of the inheritance themselves. And the guardian often was a member of the greater family, maybe an uncle or an older or younger brother of the husband that died, something like that. So also in a restricted form. Cleisthenes is sometimes called the inventor of democracy. And how do we have to understand that? We are made to believe that in the year 507, like out of the blue, an Athenian politician invents something completely new without precedent and introduces it. And that's looking at it with common sense, it makes the impression it is very strange and improbable, actually. And when we look for the reality behind this myth, then we have to dig deep. And in fact, Cleisthenes had a model that he could rely on, a model that had existed before him, long before him. In our search for the untold history of democracy, we have to dig deep, and that takes us back into remote times.
Well, and the untold story of democracy reaches back to old Europe?
That's right. Back Europe actually is the era when democracy originated. And in antiquity, the majority of the population lived in village communities. Yeah. And the first villages in southeastern Europe, and especially in Greece, were founded by the ancient Europeans, those who built the civilization of old Europe. And they did not know social hierarchy, which means that there was no village chief that would have owned the whole place or all the land and would have commanded the villagers what to do. Instead, they were self-governing and self-supporting. They chose among themselves members of a council, and the council chose a head of the council. But that was all through election. So nobody assumed power.
Yeah.
And so the head of the council had authority, but he didn't have power unless he negotiated with the council. And there were also towns. Old Europe was the first civilization when towns emerged in the history of humankind. In the fourth and already in the fifth millennium. And some of these towns had inhabitants of, numbers of inhabitants of 7,000 or 10,000 or even more. So there were big towns, and they were two or three times bigger than the first Mesopotamian towns, but they came later, they originated later.
They had already two-story houses.
And infrastructure. The archaeologists, when they excavated those towns, were amazed that in those towns you don't find any center. You don't find palaces, and you don't find buildings that are more richly equipped in the interior and would be a sign that there was an elite, because such an elite did not exist. Mm. So how did they govern and such towns? And how was administration possible? Well, there is a theory, and this sounds very probable. There were neighborhoods. So in the map of the towns, you can see there are different areas that are more closely together, and then streets separating those areas. And one can speak of neighborhoods. And it is assumed that in these neighborhoods, clans or greater families live together, and they did the same what the villagers did. Mm. They elected members for a council, and the council took care of administration of the neighborhood. Mm. And in the villages and in the towns, there was the question, how do we, where do we get food, and how do we support our people? And villages as well as towns were self-supporting. So that means they took care of their own support. And the surplus of harvest and what they produced, they traded among themselves. So there was no social elite, and therefore everything was in communal hands. The ancient Europeans, by their culture and language, were totally different from the Greeks. The Greeks are Indo-Europeans, and they came to Greece much later. The ancient Europeans had already established all what is mentioned, villages and towns, and they called their villages kome. That is a term that the Greeks later adopted as a loanword. And the Greeks came in the third millennium. Their ancestors were nomads of the Eurasian steppe. And they didn't know stable villages. They had their tent camps that were transferred from one place to the other. And when they migrated to Greece, they didn't know the stable, the model of stable settlements. And when they came to Greece, they saw what the ancient Europeans had established. So they called the ancient Europeans, and that is, that means the descendants of the very early ancient Europeans, they called them Pelasgoi, and that is related to the term Pelas, in the neighborhood. So the Greeks settled in the neighborhood of those people who had already this infrastructure. And they had a look, how do they organize themselves? And since they didn't have anything like it themselves, they adopted the model of communal administration they found among the Pelasgians and transferred it to their own village communities, which they called demos. And demos in Greek means, since Hellenistic times, it meant nation, people, all Greeks. But in the early times, demos was only a name for a village. And the term demos has a Indo-European root. And this root actually means the area where a settlement is established. It doesn't mean, or it referred later only to the people, and which means that the people belong to the land, but not the other way around, that the land belongs to the people. So this is the perspective of a society where you don't have private property. But the Greeks introduced social hierarchy, and they introduced private property. But still in Mycenaean times, in the second millennium, there was a balance between communal property and private property. And this balance existed, had already existed for a long time.
And did communal ownership survive into, let's say, classic Greece?
yes, it survived. So after the Mycenaean era, for many centuries into the future, yes, it survived, and we have communal ownership also in classical Greece. That means in the 4th and even 3rd centuries. There is a good example to explain how that worked. There is a community in ancient Greece called Torikos, and that community is located at some distance from Athens, but not far away. And this community was one of the richest in all of Greece. And why? Because they had silver mines. And the silver mines were always in communal property. They never allowed foreign investors or owners to buy these silver mines. But they gave license to outsiders, to experts who operated the mines, and they had to pay part of their revenue and then taxes to the community. Mm-hmm. So that was a strict communal enterprise. And the people of Torikos were rich, and the wealth was distributed equally for the benefit of all people living in the community. And they could afford to build a theater, because yeah. only very rich communities could afford that. And it is interesting that the poets of that time had two choices, and two choices with prestige. They could try to get their plays performed either in the Dionysos Theatre in Athens or in the Theatre of Torikos. And there you see communal ownership worked and it was stable. And now let's have a look again what Cleisthenes did. So the communal self-governing administration of settlements did exist for a long time, and it existed at the time of Cleisthenes. And what Cleisthenes did was not inventing this model, but he could rely on the long-term experience with this useful model in the village communities and in the early towns. So what he did was he adopted this model for the level of state organization. That's what he did. And this is his achievement. But at the same time, it is good to say he transformed the existing model of democracy, because in a way he reduced it. In old Europe, we had an egalitarian society and gender equality, which means that men and women were on equal terms and they cooperated in public and in private life, and then took part in village administration. But he specialized the model of state organization and excluded women, so that only the men had rights as citizens in public life. And that was something that perhaps crippled the essence of democracy. So it is strange to see that the older, wider range of democratic principles that was practiced in the older model was reduced. And so what Cleisthenes then adopted and transformed was a reduced model. And one can say, since this model promoted also private ownership and social hierarchy, there was the seed for conflict of later days.
Yeah.
So perhaps let's summarize in a way, let's keep in mind that the whole range of democratic principles is to be found only in the untold story of democracy. So beware, do not reduce the range of democratic principles.
Well, the good thing about history is that one can learn from it, isn't it?
Yeah.
But unfortunately, during almost 5 millennia, we made no use of it. We developed inequality, steep hierarchies, repeated imperialism, developed nations, produced and continue to reproduce nationalism. Nationalism reaches out at us by stigmatizing the other, the stranger, with despising terms: human flesh, breath, pest breath, carrier of virus and pathogens, afflictions. This is terribly dangerous.
Right. Words are not simply words, because they can carry a load of meaning. And in case they have extreme negative meaning, this certainly affects people's thinking and their actions.
Well, clearly using such terms is a deliberate decision pro-nationalism and contra an open society. It's a dirty trick. Mussolini once revealed this trick. Listen, you have to tear out a chicken's feathers one by one to avoid attention for a long time. Mm. It's incredible, huh? Mm-hmm. It takes a while until one becomes aware of those tricks and the consequences. Sometimes too long, as history shows.
But there is hope.
Yes. Fortunately, there are people around the world with their antennas out and their eyes and ears wide open who are protesting against this inhuman use of language and all it transports with it, like a Trojan horse. And that's good. Harald, you and I, we share the view of those who believe in the power of education, reflection, and responsible action.
And there are clear signs that the communal spirit of old fabric can be revived. I just think of two examples. One is the idea of buurzorg in the Netherlands. And that means buurzorg, the neighborhood, and how people take care of people in the neighborhood. So this buurzorg organization is a self-governing local institution, and they don't have a central bureaucracy, and the members of the teams that give medical care to elderly people in the neighborhood, or who assist people if they need help, they are recruited from the inhabitants of a neighborhood. That means those who take care of the others are themselves members, and everyone is familiar with the other. They know one another. And that gives a kind of sense of solidarity that you cannot have when someone from outside comes to give medical care. And the other example is from a community in Finnish Lapland. The name of this community is Kelontekemä, and that is about 40 miles at the distance of 40 miles from the nearest town, which is Kittilä. And people in Kelontekemä don't wait for public services to reach them all the time, or maybe they'll be late. So they took initiative and formed neighborhood groups for themselves. During winter, they clear the roads of snow, and they build fences, and they clear the ditches, and do other things for the common good in the community. And they even dig ditches for the cables, because the cable company says it's too expensive for them this work to do this work for only a few hundred users. And so they do it themselves. And it's a practice. So it's a functioning community, a self-governing community, you could say. So like the people in old Europe who were united in similar economic interests and worldview, grounded in solidarity, these examples I gave show that this spirit of solidarity can be revived, and it's only a matter of the initiative. And I'm sure that this can be revived even on a larger scale. It's only a question of initiative, indeed.
But can one say that similar interest, economic interest, as you said, combined with mutual trust, where the pillars of 3,000 years of sustained community life?
Yeah, that's a good comparison.
And they were firmly rooted. I think the societies of old Europe were successful because everybody would profit. Those who made more profit contributed more to the community. And a shared quality of life with little distinction between the fortunate and the less fortunate that held them together. Everyone seems to have been aware of the necessity and the value of contributing to guarantee sustainability, right?
Yes, to the point.
Well, could they have known that fighting for land or property would threaten their well-being?
Yes, I think they had a sense for it. With aggressive behavior, they would have destroyed their infrastructure. It is well known that aggressive behavior poisons democratic structures.
Well, would you agree that the foundational conditions for democracy are the following? A basic sense of honesty, of self-control, and of respect for one another, of respect in dealing with one another.
Yes, exactly. And if these preconditions are undermined, democracy loses balance and will start to crumble and finally collapse. And there is another aspect, fear. Fear for personal security. It alters people's thinking. Under the pressure of fear, they more readily follow those who would instrumentalize that fear.
And it would be disastrous if fear made us more and more shift away from the basic conditions of democracy with their preciously long tradition. But well, fear for personal security, the consequences of climate change and exploitation of our planet, and the threat of nationalism justify fear. And yes, fear opens the door for populism and nationalism. But, Harald, fear can also mobilize us to search for solutions, can't it?
Indeed it can. We should talk about the nature of conflict and the chance of solutions in our next video. For now, let us conclude. The untold story of democracy is about the societies of old Europe. Their way of life unfolded under the auspices of the elementary qualities of democracy, which are honesty, self-control, and respect, fueled solidarity among men and women equally. In shared economic interest and mutual trust, they gained and sustained stability. These principles have shown their usefulness throughout the ages. Thinking of the generations to come, who are we to abandon such principles?
Yeah. Well then, until next time.
From heart to heart.
From heart to heart.